Okay. My name is Evan Miller. I'm going to talk about the Fedora Linux build service, something I've been working on for kind of enough time. This is actually something that we finished once before.
You have to stand in front of it, left up, where they want to be on the video.
No, I'll be on the video as I pace and do the... I want to make sure the slides were in panel, so I feel like those require a little bit more context. My voice will be on the video. Anyways, so we actually finished this once before, and then the Docker format changed and some universal truths were no longer true, so we got to start over again. But now we're pretty much done already. A couple things, I'll talk about what those things are in a bit. And let me figure out how to wait for it. No.
Is it started?
It should be started. Just working in, we go. Yeah, okay. Alright, so we're going to talk about I'm going to discuss what we're going to talk about today. And if these topics don't sound interesting to you, feel free to exit. You will not hurt my feelings. Please find something that you do find interesting, because there's a lot of great stuff going on. Wow. So, we're going to define what containers are in the context of Linux systems. I like to do this just because it kind of level sets what this is, where the motivation came from, why they're doing this kind of thing. Talk directly about Docker, because it has certain implications in design and why we need a new build system like this. We're going to go ahead and talk about Docker build, which is the doc file, and again, why that leads into the system that we've created. We're going to talk about release engineering for the context of why the build system is necessary to kind of constrain the build environment that can become a lot less. We will then talk about the Docker layer, the image build service itself, which is comprised of OpenShift, the OpenShift build service known as osbs, Koji container build, which is the plugin that allows us to tie it into Koji and as well as tie it into all of the tooling that current Fedora contributors know and love, or more maybe not. Docker layer image build service, Fedora implementation, and how we specifically do certain things, and then we'll get to Q&A. I forgot that there's going to be a demo in this area. We will actually demo something.
Okay.
So containers aren't actually new. They're kind of an old topic. They used to be known as operating system virtualization. We like to call them containers. Effectively, it allows to do multi-tenant execution of applications without modifying the application. And you can kind of confine them within namespaces. They don't, by definition, inherently provide security. We've added a lot of security wrapping around them as time has gone on, but this is effective that they allow you to, confine different execution namespaces. So, containers, I like to argue that the truth was the original container. It was unsophisticated. It allowed you to actually take an application and execute it in a context outside of what it originally should be. You lied to it about what a true file system was, but the application thinks that was its view of the world, and it was correct, and life went on. Time went on, and there were a lot of more sophisticated, not necessarily widely used in the Linux world or not available to Linux. PSGLs, Linux V Service, Linux Zones, OpenVZ, LXC. LXCs were things really got interesting. So IBM wrote this tool chain that allowed for use and access to things that are available in the component, but folks, user space to actually set up runtimes and confine them. So one of the layers, system begin spawn, kind of expanded on top of that using similar system capabilities, similar API, similar components of the kernel to even further confine these things. Interesting factoid, they actually created this originally to test systemd. They want to be able to test, rapidly, iteratively test systemd without having to reboot machines. So they want to be able to spawn an NS system inside of a container. So 2013 dot cloud releases Docker, and it originally uses LXC. So this is why I think LXC is where historic lineage gets interesting, is because dot cloud, original iteration of Docker, used LXC on the back end. That has been replaced by a thing called libc container. And why Docker is really popular and why it's so interesting is because it defined a lot of standard workflow components. So you have this concept of an image, and then a container is an instance of that image. And then the image format itself can be easily redistributed, and the distribution mechanism is easily hosted in your own environment, easily replicated, those kinds of things. So a lot of the things that were a little bit more pile of parts, build your own, they kind of provided tooling around how to do that, and that's kind of... Yeah. So, 2014 CoreOS made Rocket. Rocket is a similar, it's a different solution to the similar problem space, and that is, they created an application specification and image format specification, and they created Rocket as a reference implementation of that, which kind of, the two efforts, I think, Docker and CoreOS led to the OCI, which is, yeah, so the Open Container Project created the OCI, which is the Open Container Initiative. I don't know if they actually renamed one or the other officially. But basically, a bunch of companies got together and said, hey, we need to have standards on this stuff. We need to have things that are portable. So now you can actually have an OCI application image that is runnable on different execution engines. And execution engines in this context would be Docker or Rocket. the reason that's kind of interesting, in my opinion, just because that leads to this thing called RunC, which is the ability to then execute unprivileged container runtimes from images that you wouldn't be able to otherwise run in, you know, Docker or Rocket. And as of Docker engine version 1.11, this is actually how Docker itself runs applications. So you can actually, they actually took the components and then kind of like rework their internal engine and everything. And then 2016 container D happened, which is a daemon that can orchestrate multiple RunC execution environments, which is effectively how, again, Docker will be 1.11 handles this. And it lets you run containers as they comply with OCI specification. Now, the big history lesson is basically just because this didn't just kind of magically happen overnight. Docker is not the only execution environment, but they are without a doubt the most popular one. And Docker. So Docker itself has a handful of things that need to be taken into account, mostly just for execution runtime and also for image creation. So the Docker engine, once upon a time known as Docker Daemon, still known as Docker Daemon in a lot of vocabulary worlds, especially in man pages documentation for how to actually execute and or run the Docker engine, is your single point of entry. It's an API that can be accessed over Unix socket or remotely over HPS. Well, yes, pretty sure it's only HPS. Containers are instances of images. You have to build an image, and images are built in a standard way using a Docker file, and that's interesting. That is what kind of led to, I think, the ubiquity of people thinking that Docker is containers and containers are Docker, because it provided a standard tooling, so you had this thing, and this thing that you end up with effectively just a toggle of toggles and metadata. And then the combination of those toggles and metadata tells Docker engine what to do, and you get these instances of the running thing. SLA support is in Docker, thanks to Mr. Dan Walsh.
Set enforcement again.
Anyways, okay, so portal backends for isolation, for storage, networking, those kind of things. So Docker adds a lot of flexibility around the original idea of this operating system level virtualization and this concept of containers. And the main thing that we're going to focus on is the images themselves, because we want to create them. However, we need to understand there's a difference between Docker images that are considered base images or platform images and an application layered image. So the base image is generally something that your distribution is going to produce through their standard operating system building mechanisms. So Fedora, Debian, Arch, SUSE, Alpine, everybody who creates a base image creates it from nothing and just slaps down a root file system and then ships it out. And then everybody else will create their application layered image on top of that. So the reason that it's called the application, the Docker layered image build system is because This is for the Fedora contributors to actually build layered images that we can then ship and distribute from Fedora content sources. And I say content because it can be a combination of code and content. You know, if you want to package up on the cloud or something into a series of document images. So here's a basic Docker file. You have a from stanza, which again is going to be from your base image. Base image for everybody in the room. Also going to be Fedora. If not, we are always looking to improve. Let us know how we can get you to use from Fedora. Maintain entry, run stanzas, expose, which will expose ports, add files, run things, enter command entry points. There's a whole lot of other things that you can put in here, stanzas, the documentation is very verbose, please check it out. But I want to at least kind of point something out is that the flexibility for this is effectively the same as a shell script, which is great, it's very powerful, it's very convenient, it allows you to get up and running very quickly, gives you flexibility in many ways, but it also makes it very hard to replicate a build. And if you're thinking about building images in such a way that you can reproduce them and you can replicate them, that's very difficult because if somebody were to slap in one of these run stanzas a call pipe the bash command from Bob Johnson Project.io and you have this binary image that's been built and you're running containers based off that, and Bob Johnson Project.io disappears and you can't do rebuilds anymore because your install source has been destroyed, or you can't do updates anymore. That becomes an interesting problem from the, you know, the concept of, I'll get to that now. But, so here's the optimal build, and this is mostly just to show that each step spawns up a new layer, so each time we get a checksum, it's a new layer, adding to the name for Docker layer image. And we actually do a splotch, so we splotch a lot of these, you know, ones that do like DNF installs, they don't necessarily need the back-end DNF installs. But anyways, so this is the piece that I want to talk about in terms of what's interesting about the, you know, the fact that it's difficult to reproduce or having not having sanitization of your sources and not having a recipe by which we can go back or having an audit trail. So what is release engineering? Release engineering, a software production pipeline that is reproducible, auditable, definable, and deliverable. This is a definition that I yanked off of Wikipedia, because I can't really find anybody who defined it better than this. And this is by Boris Dedek of Google. And it's essentially that release engineering is the difference between manufacturing software in small teams or startups and manufacturing software in an industrial way that is repeatable and gives predictable results and scales well. Which are things that we want to have for Docker images, just that we have them today for RPMs. We're going to revisit the release engineering point. I just wanted to touch on that because as we go through and talk about why we've made some of the design choices and why it's been put together this way, it relates back to that because we do want that those components. So OpenShift. OpenShift is a container runtime platform. It's open source and is developed by Red Hat primarily. It is based on a technology called Kubernetes, which was originally used by Google. Red Hat's another big contributor to it. There's two editions, there's OpenShift Origin and there's OpenShift Enterprise. OpenShift Enterprise is the product version, I'm just trying to tell it to you, it's not all here. OpenShift Origin is what we use in Fedora for the build. And the reason we do this is because OpenShift provides a lot of really nice things. The main thing that we care about that we find very interesting in this particular problem space is the build automation. So, really quick, the reason, okay. So OpenShift general overlay, and this is like a bird's eye view because it gets way off and gets down in the load. But you have a massive amount of nodes, and each node will run a series of pods, and each pod will have multiple containers in it. And that what that is interesting, and the reason we talk about that is because it shows that OpenShift itself can scale, so that we can actually inherently, by using it for its build pipeline, we can actually scale the build service by scaling OpenShift and then letting OpenShift schedule resources as necessary for the builds. Okay. So it's a standard platform, and the advanced features are the build pipeline, image streams, application lifecycle management, CI/CD integration, binary deployment, triggers, So the triggers and the build pipelines are going to be very interesting to us in how we build all this. So REST API, command line interface, IDE, web UI, for our uses, we don't worry about that. But so because we're trying to build images, we need these build pipelines. So the OSBS is OpenShift build service, and basically what we do is we take OpenShift origin, an upstream project called Atomic Reactor, and then the OSBS client API, and we kind of shove them together, and this solution becomes the OSBS. And what we do is we create we create a new build primitive inside of OpenShift, and what that does is that defines a new configuration and tells the system characteristics of our build. Because the build pipeline actually has, it comes with pre-described methods of build that are going to be common for those people, but it also provides a framework to define your own. So we define our own, and that will then, as a side effect, define what our inputs can be. What's interesting about that is going back to input sanitization, we can actually do sanitization of our inputs inherent to the build primitive. So we have a definition of what can go into the build. We rely on OpenShift for scheduling, and again, that goes back to this, being able to scale the build system is the same as being able to scale OpenShift. I think OpenShift Enterprise has a reference customer that's got something involved with them. Like 100,000 nodes, or no, tens of thousands, so a lot of nodes. More of the story is we can theoretically scale the build system larger than we have available hardware for in the Fedora world, so we should be good there. So it presents this defined component to developer builders for the command line and Python API, and what becomes interesting there is that we can then tie into it using common tools that we already have, which is what we've done, to allow Fedora contributors to actually build these kinds of things. So OSBS enforces that inputs come from auditable sources, so a git repo for source, a Docker file, git commits and builds are essentially logged. Our build root is a limited Docker runtime. So build root is a very just overloaded term. If you say that word without context, it's meaningless. What it means to us is that we create a Docker image that is pre-populated with all the things that you would need to actually perform a Docker layer image build inside of OSBS. So it's going to contain the atomic reactor command, which I'll talk about in a second in a little bit more detail. But atomic reactor does a lot of the automated process around the build. It handles a lot of metadata. It handles a lot of the uploads, responsibilities, those kind of things. It is an unprivileged container runtime with SCLs enforcing. Inputs are sanitized before reaching the build phase, and unknown and unvetted source are disallowed. And it's firewall constrained. So we actually do firewall constraint at the Docker bridge interface. So anytime the system spins up a Docker container instance, the container instance's network gets joined to the Docker bridge interface, and that Docker bridge interface has restrictions. So we've confined it in every possible way we can think of. If you can think of another one, please talk to us. We'd love to know. We want to keep this as locked down as possible. just like the current RPM builders are. I mean, we don't want to allow the RPM builders and Koji to just like randomly pull things from the internet. We need to have our input sanitized. So we then use OpenShift image streams as input to the build root. And the reason we do that is OpenShift image streams are effectively pointers to remote Docker registries. So for those who aren't familiar, Docker registry is kind of similar to an RPM repo. It just comes with all of like Docker's nomenclature and then metadata format and their strategies for pulling metadata and then image layers and those kinds of things. And what's great about that is as we build out our environment and we create more registries or we add more components to it, we can just update the image stream pointer and it will aggregate the data and refresh metadata as prescribed in the image stream definition. So it utilizes OpenShift triggers to spawn rebuild actions based on parent image changes. Now this comes with an asterisk that we're still working on this. But it is in the design doc. It's there's documentation out there for things that are being worked on in that space. However, that is a goal such that right now I think there's a locked up report out there that shows something like 73% of Docker images that are advertised to host web content are still vulnerable to, what is it, Podly or something, that are on the Docker Hub. So if you go to hub.docker.com, anybody can upload anything they want. What ends up happening is a lot of people just upload things and abandon them. And then people are just pulling these binary blobs and just using them at face value. And that's fine if you trust where your content comes from. We would like to be able to build trust around our industry and that our content comes from, the content people pull from us is from a reputable source that isn't. There's bugs, and they're flying around my space.
Okay,
squash the bugs. So, atomic-reactor is a single-pass Docker build tool used inside of constrained builder in OSBS. Now, the inside constrained builder in OSBS is something that we do. You can use atomic-reactor face value on your laptops if you want. You don't have to use it the way we use it. But it's a very, very cool standalone tool on its own, and we use it with great success inside of OSBS. So it automates tasks for all kinds of things, and it does so like a plugin. So there's plugins to push images, you can inject repositories, you can change the base image, so you can actually, in your configuration file, say, okay, if the from image is Fedora, it actually needs to be, you know, myregistry.foo.com/Fedora or something, and you can, without modifying the originating Docker file, you can kind of do that swap and inject. You can match the registry is available inside the isolated build root, you can run simple tasks after build. It'll also automatically upload registries, and it's just a whole bunch of plugins that I didn't list here because they're not exactly directly related to what we do, but it's a good tool. So we use that inside of OSBS. It's actually originally created from the same upstream project that created OSBS. So just as a side note, OSBS client and atomic reactor come from projectatomic.org. There's actually an upstream. It's all open source. Fedora did not create them. We are a consumer and a contributor, but we are not the creators. We are big fans. Okay, so getting updates. So our new test suite time, we're actually working with Fedora QA group right now. We want to move automated testing into Task Control. We're going to have it all fired off of Fed messages. It'll all be automatic. And then we're going to have promoting of images from candidate or... candidate. I don't know why I blanked on the term, the vocabulary term, but yeah. From candidate to then either production or stable, depending on how you want to mix and match the registry terms. But we'll effectively tag the image and move it wholesale as an unmodified component. So the thing that is tested is released, that kind of thing. So, Fedora's implementation. So we have a layer image build maintainers, that is hopefully all of you. You will then interact with distgit just like you do for RPMs, but we've namespaced distgit. So now there's now you can fed package clone RPM/. So what I'm going to do is cockpit. By show of hands, remember who's familiar with cockpit? All right, now I'll do the help. Before we do the demo, I'll quickly introduce cockpit. So we can actually look at RPM's namespace and actually look at the RPMs of the spec file and source code and the patch set and everything. And then we can do the Docker namespace in distgit and just get the Docker file, the service init script. And then eventually we're going to add the tests and docs. When we add integration and task control, there'll be a test directory and those kind of things. So distgit, then you'll execute the fedpkg container build command, which will fire off Koji. And Koji being where, you know, RPM builds happen, container build, ISO, everything happens to Koji is our central hub of build all the things. And that container build plugin will be in there, and this will go out and it will request that OSBS generate or schedule this build. And OpenShift Origin has the REST API, which is where the request will originally go in. The atomic reactor will be run inside of the build root, and it will perform the build for us. And then all of this is handled through the OSBS client API. And the reason there's two APIs is because Node's origin REST API does a whole lot of things. Now, OSBS client effectively allows us to use OpenShift in a certain pre-prescribed way for our exact build type. So this presents the components you need from the like grand OpenShift, and we can just use it in the pre-prescribed method we want. And it also provides Python API bindings, which Fedora loves Python, so that worked for us. Now, the build will happen, and then we will actually immediately ship the build out to the candidate image registry. Right now, there's actually only one registry. We have a project underway to expand on that, but it'll send it out to the registry, then we can immediately pull it and test it and those kinds of things, and that will go out to the users. Now, the registry will also have data imported into Koji. There's a component in Koji called a content generator metadata build. And what that is that Koji will fire off a build, and then it will then import all the necessary information into the Koji database for historic reasons and for being able to do build root reproduction, those kind of things, which brings us back to the release engineering aspect of this. We can then reproducibly create these images because we will know exactly the list of components that go into it. We will know exactly the git commit ID from distgit where its sources originated, and we can verify its input, its content input sources, because we have limited the build routes to not allow external sources to be injected. So we know where it originated, we are the providers, and we can then recreate it if we need to. And then the users will download it. So, distgit, so again, each branch is a Fedora release. I suspect most people know that, but just in case. Fed package is show of hands, who's using Fed package? Who's like currently maintaining stuff? Okay, so Fed package, for those who don't know, is it's a package maintainer helper tool. It allows you to kind of navigate through some Git different things and do it in such in the context of your content. You can initiate builds, local, remote, mock integration. Koji is our authoritative build system. Everything in Fedora is built there. Everything is in Fedora is built there in one way or another. Everything from USB images to cloud images and OSBS. So container build is a plugin that will orchestrate between Koji and OSBS, and then we have our registry, which is the Docker upload entry point. Now, before we go into questions, we're going to do some demos. Oh, right. Font size isn't good, everybody?
Yes.
All right. Now, I didn't mirror the display, which I think is a mistake now. All right. So, let's just look at tree. Oh. What is it? One? No. Why do you hate... I can't remember. I don't use tree all that often. Oh yeah, that's gonna be bad. Do that now? Okay, thank you. I should know that. Okay. So, I don't have Kubernetes in here. Let's just forget that's even there. Yeah, it's fine. Okay, so in my FedPkg repository, I have namespaces. So I have stage, which is actually my stage, and inside of stage, I have another Dockin RPMs. But we have Dockin RPMs, and we have that namespace such that we can actually go into. So let's go into Docker, and so I'm just going to just nuke this, so we can then FedPkg clone Docker cockpit. Oh, and I said really quick I would go .org. Oh, why do you hate me? Huzzah! Okay, so Cockpit is this really cool web UI that gives you the ability to manage your servers. It's not crazy like cPanel, it's actually integrated, it does everything on the DBus, and it has some really nice integration with systems. It's very minimal footprint. And you can get a shell on your system, and you can launch Docker, and it'll orchestrate Kubernetes and OpenShift and all kinds of interesting things. So it was built in RPM. Oh, right. Yay! All right. So we have it namespace here. So we have Docker cockpit, which is going to pull the Docker component. So we have our atomic install, atomic run, atomic uninstall. So for those who aren't familiar, Project Atomic has an atomic command, and the atomic command allows you to actually install containerized applications and use labels inside of your Docker file to run certain commands at install time, at uninstall, those kinds of things. So we look at our Docker file. There's a handful of labels, and the ones that we care about from the aspect of being a Docker language maintainer is the BC component, which can be a bug zilla component so that users know where to report issues. The name, which is going to be Fedora/cockpit. Version, which will actually come from the version label, which is down here, I'll show in a second. Release and architecture. Now, eventually we want to support all the architectures. Right now it's x86-64 only for a handful of reasons, mostly the Docker registry. So Docker itself will actually run on multiple architectures. Docker registry doesn't have a really well-defined, standardized way of how to distribute multi-architecture images yet. So we're trying to sort that out. And but for now, we live with x86-64. And then, let's see. So then we have the label for install, uninstall, run, and this is where the atomic command will actually use these labels to perform things. But going back really quick, we'll just go ahead and, so the end release and version is where these are populated. I'm sorry, I thought they came from labels down below. So we're going to just bump this for sake of the demo. We'll go ahead and I'm sorry, I have that's git add. I have macros because I'm lazy. I'll go ahead and type up git commit minus m dump release for demo. Git push. Fed package container build. Yeah, no, I'm doing this, 100% live on Koji, sorry.
Is that the release package version, or is that something that you put in the package,
you
might imagine as the container
build command?
The Fed package that you're running here,
yeah.
Is it your own, or is that the official
Optimum
version?
No, that's the official, that's Fedora 24's Fed package, yeah. Yeah, so the question was if this is the official Fed package or if this was like my own fork. No, we got the patches that are needed into Fed package and they're part of F24. So we can see here that we've got our task info, which has our URL and Koji, which everybody should, you know, kind of recognize. It's going out, it's scheduling the create container job, which this is firing off to talk to OSBS. Now we will go ahead and copy. I'm not using with my normal. Go away. Nope. Stop it. Okay. So, oh good, that failed. Wait, you know what? That might have been old. I think that it did fail at input. What happened?
Should we trace back in the console? Same in the odds.
It might have been. Go back. Well, the demo guy's not with me today.
Oh, sure, sure. That's helpful.
Yeah. Okay, well, here's a little bin fail. and under show results, you'll see, or should, when you do a build, you should see where it's available, the registry, and you can actually go ahead and just grab that URL. So it's tagged a handful of different ways. So there's a unique identifier, which is created just based on date and, I think, epoch time value. The actual name, version release tag, and then we'll actually do an update latest. For those not familiar, latest is kind of a magical tag in Fedora space, such that if you don't provide one, it just assumes latest. If you don't provide a tag of any sort, it just assumes latest. Latest is meant to always track the latest version of your image. So if you do Docker pull Fedora, Docker on the back end actually assumes that what you meant was Docker pull Fedora colon latest. So if you just did, you know, Docker pull /cockpit, it would just assume latest. Anyways, point is, these are where you can get those things, but we can actually drill down one better and see information about the container build. And we can show results, which will have information about this, and then the build log, which is very long and verbose. And for anybody familiar with atomic reactor, this will probably look familiar. But this is kind of the debug output and shows you all kinds of stuff. And then,
oh, did I not pull it up? I sure didn't. Let's see, how long does it take?
I do have time. Yeah, I was really hoping to show the content generator thing. Content generator import. If it'll show me results.
Okay, may have popped up the detail.
I wanted to see the. No, the so the content generator import gives a list of all the RPMs that go into the build group, and it's just not showing me them now. I have this all pulled up before the session, and it's just gone.
That's
what you get for doing it
live. Well, you know.
Okay. Well, anyways, the content generator metadata import will actually give us the full manifest of the sources that went into the build route, including the list of RPMs that came from the repository name version releases, so that if we ever needed to, we actually recreate a new Koji build repository to then feed into the build, and then we could also provide the specific git URI, including the hash value, so we could go ahead and completely recreate using the same set of inputs that same image output. I won't guarantee binary compatibility bit for bit because I don't think anybody does that. I know Debian's trying to, but I don't know if he's actually doing that. And there have been discussions on whether or not it's actually a goal worth chasing. But anyways, so that's the workflow. I will find out what just broke with my demo. But we're hoping to go live with this very soon. It's in production in terms of the infrastructure. We're waiting on some kind of note or bookkeeping components to go into Bugzilla. We have packaging guidelines that we're iterating on. If you have any input on those, please join the Fedora Cloud Working Group, either in our meetings or on the mailing list, because that's kind of where we're driving most of the container stuff. Containers and Docker seem to be very prevalent or tied to cloud topics, those kind of things. So that's where we're trying to do those. Yes. But yes. Woo! Okay, so the comment was the Bugzilla component is done. You can actually go into Fedora's Bugzilla and enter. Okay, you can go in. Okay, so they're probably very soon, maybe while we're at Block for Kicks, we'll just make an announcement to the world that you can actually create these things now. We have guidelines and then approved through FESCO. So we have everything. We all really lost some place. We just need actually, I guess, everyone to fix what I broke during my demo, and then unleash upon the world. Now, I will say with caveat, we will not be unleashing the floodgates initially. We're going to kind of roll into this slowly just because we don't yet have any real knowledge of what our capacity for builds are, build throughput is at this time. That's actually something that I'm going to start working on probably in 2 weeks, is the scale out deployment of our build system to be able to open the floodgates. So we're not, there will be a little bit of lag time before we are able to just dockerize all the things, but we are working on it. Yes, sir? That's another thing. So deliveries and mirrors, how we're going to manage registries, those kind of things, that's another initiative that we're working on. Randy Barlow is going to probably be technical lead on that. I'm going to assist the best I can. But we're going to work that one out too. Because mirroring dot composition. Yes?
Okay. So comment and question. Comment is for anybody who actually wants to learn the labels and everything else that we need for building the data for that. That's part of the workshop I'm doing on Thursday. So we'll follow up on that. The question is, what can we do to make sure that people reuse layers as much as possible?
Put in guidelines. I mean, we need to have, so there's currently a set of guidelines out there that I wrote purely because they need to be written, not because I think I have the best guidelines available to give to everyone, but somebody had to write something down. So I did, and we didn't get a lot of feedback, so if anybody has feedback, please provide it, because I love some of these ideas that are better than mine. And basically, we're going to go through the similar workflow that you have for RPM. So you'll create a review request, and we'll go in and review and make sure that your doc file is not doing anything crazy, and that your sources that you're pulling from are within Fedora, and other things that we can distribute, those kind of things. So adding labels and things I would like to get into our guidelines. There's a handful of labels that are already listed there for name, version, release, and Bugzilla component. Those are required. If those are not provided, the build system will actually kick the build out and say that it failed because it's missing any required pieces. Yes?
You mentioned packaging guidelines, and how are these going to end up in Fedora? Is it like a normal packaging guideline? Obviously, I care.
So there's a it hasn't gone live yet, but I have pushed it through FESCO and been approved. There is a set of guidelines for Docker that is going to be separate from RPM. They are similar in workflow, but it is a separate set of guidelines, mostly because we understand that somebody who's a packager isn't inherently going to be an expert on containers, and vice versa. You know, somebody who knows the way around containers is building Docker files isn't necessarily going to know the intricacies of RPM spec files and those kinds of things. So we do want to keep them in parallel, but not necessarily merged together.
I just don't know what I'm going to need, because we already have a lot of workflow and stuff for formalizing guidelines for packaging in general. I don't know if you want to integrate that or if you want to keep it separate.
You decide.
Yeah.
Yes.
Well, it does be decided to let the package in.
There was a discussion of perhaps having like a separate, something equivalent to MVC or
right. Because I don't necessarily think the That's place, but it does have all of the structure, so...
Yeah, and I did, so when I did the initial proposal, I sent it to the bell list, and I think I got one person who gave me feedback. So I submitted it to the bell list again, and then I think I got one or two more people.
In other words, you turn on, you go in the fire hose and...
Right, I announce it from the mountaintop. I do to announce it, but I'm happy to follow up on it. Nothing is set in stone. Right. A big thing about not only Docker itself, but also the build system, is all of this is in flux because Docker, as a technology and also as an ecosystem, as like a user community, is constantly changing and iterating. So we will be doing the same with the build system and our guidelines and other things. So if you have ideas, please let us know. Nothing is set in stone. We are open to the world of change. Bigger, faster, iterative, all those goodness. Yes, sir?
So I'm really glad you got this far into the deployment, so...
Woo! Thank you! So, Tomas either originally wrote or was on the team who originally wrote Atomic Reactor, which is a huge component of this. So thank you, Tomas.
I have many questions, so... I just have one. So I'm planning to go through the Docker. I mean, Fedora space on Docker Hub because it's going to take so many updated images. It's really frustrating.
Yes, so the Fedora Cloud Working Group, who maintains that set of things, already has, we have a ticket and it's being tracked that once we are able to, once we have the build capacity, we're going to migrate all of the Fedora Docker files into this, and we're going to, tie in automation to where when the Docker images are released, they will be mirrored out to the hub. So if people don't want to use our registry, they can still pull from the hub and they will get the updated content. So the question was, all of the things that are under the Fedora namespace on the Docker hub right now, will we be doing something to update those? And yes, we will. That is on the roadmap, that's in the plan, it's just a matter of getting there. And that's another thing too, so we will have our registry and we want to actually do like nightly rawhide updates for people who want to pull the latest and greatest base image, but we are going to do a tie-in to do the automatic upload into the hub.
So as a picture, may I try it now, or is it not yet out?
It's not yet out officially, very soon, hopefully by the end of the week, maybe next week, but yes, very soon. Yes?
Sorry. Is same collection, is it back group?
Yes.
So currently the Docker package in Fedora is pulling from the Docker registry. So is there a way of actually defaulting the Docker package to our registry?
We can. That's a config change. We can set the default config in our package to point to our registry first and then like fall back. And once we have the scale out mirror set up for the registry, we would love to do that. So the question was, can we default to Fedora's registry for Fedora content from the Docker package to Fedora? And yes, we can. It's a config change, and we would like to in the future. Question?
What about scanning? Want to scan these images before you release them?
So scanning, we would love to. We haven't gotten there yet. Yes, so the atomic scan command, the OpenScan integrations, those kind of things, we would love to do that for security scanning. Is Patrick in the room? No, all right. So Patrick, security officer, he has brought it up to us that it's something that we do want to do. It just hasn't been done yet. What will probably happen is in the test phase, that will be a component of the test phase, we'll actually do a scan before it goes public. But yeah, that's a good point. So the question was, are we going to do security scanning on images? And yes, we want to, we're not yet. Yes?
So, her question. So the current draft guidelines say that anything built into the container has to be available as an RPM.
Correct.
So what about building containers for things that aren't available as RPMs?
Like not available yet. No, we can't do it yet. The build system will literally reject it.
Okay.
So build system's rejecting it.
Do what?
Does it reject it as a
command from the document? No, but you... So you can game the system by just dropping blobs in distgit, but we can audit that and yell at you for it. But yeah, you cannot like add remote things because we have it. Yeah. Yes. Probably last question.
Okay. So are you adding the patterns to the container runtime? For example, I need to do this
Nginx, which is only in Ohio, and on the line on Fedora, like, server, or I don't know, like, the server.
No, so you can actually do this. You can run a Fedora 24 container on Fedora 22 if you want with Docker. Like, that's kind of the goal of Docker, to be able to allow that to mix and match. Absolutely. All right, that's fine. Thank you all so much.